As we discussed last time, why do we need an Angular? Because from the day one, when we started developing a web application, it was a pure HTML. Our browser supports or understands only the HTML part. Once your browser gets loaded, once your application gets loaded into the browser, so everything is getting copied into the HTML. Means the HTML is nothing but your DOM element. Whether you create a button, whether you create a text box, whether you create a particular CSS classes and all those things. Everything is a part of your DOM. Document object model. Just like I showed you last time. So if you see, if I'm opening any website, let's take an example, godaddy.com. This is the website for hosting your application. I'm right clicking here, click on inspect. This is nothing but the HTML they have created. Okay, whatever, because the browser supports and understand only the HTML part. So whatever it is getting rendered on the browser, everything is being a part of your DOM, document object model. If you wanted to customize this, if you wanted to changing the styles and everything, so whatever you are going to do it, everything is going to be updated onto the DOM element. So before Angular, we were developing the HTML, so we did not have a control to change the DOM element dynamically at the runtime. It won't be possible in the HTML side. Then JavaScript came into the picture, which can perform any action on the DOM element. But it was having some limited options to perform the operations. Then AngularJS and other some scripting languages came into the picture, which will perform or do the operation onto the DOM element, just like doing the styling and all those things. So what we were using JavaScript to performing the operations, we have inbuilt methods over there. Similarly, we have the jQuery, which is also doing the same thing which JavaScript was doing it. Only the difference between JavaScript and the jQuery was, jQuery has some inbuilt features which is provided by the Google. For example, if I wanted to hide a particular section, what we were doing it, we have to use document.getElementById in bracket. You need to specify the ID of the control, the name of the control, the class of the control, we call it as a selector. But in jQuery, we can also do the same way, but has given us a very smaller functions, which we can utilize it to make it work on the DOM element. So it has already inbuilt code and all those things. We need to write a lot over there, which jQuery provides us. But still, when we talk about to communicate with the database and all those things, we had some HTTP client object. We can make a call to the, we can make a AJAX call to the APIs, which will perform the operations on the database side or on the server side. Okay, that's okay. But what was the problem with the jQuery in the JavaScript was, if I wanted to make a synchronous, asynchronous call, it was having some issues. It was not giving 100% result. Asynchronous call means, for example, I have two grids. One grid is for employee data. Another grid was displaying employee performance data. I wanted to load the data simultaneously. And that means I need to make a two API calls to render the data onto the client browser. So earlier, what was happening in the monolithic approach, first get the data from the first request, then it will move to the next request to pull the details of the performance of your employees. So it was not improving our web-based applications, because nowadays what happened, everybody is looking for user-friendly applications, responsive applications, so that user feels Very comfortable over there. See, this is a very amazing website. The data is getting loaded very easily. So these are the things. So now, that when the Angular came into the market, before that there was an AngularJS application, AngularJS framework. AngularJS, what it was doing, it has also the same feature, whatever you have in the jQuery and the JavaScript. Only the methodology and performing the operations, designing the things, it's totally different. We can utilize our object-oriented programming concepts and each and everything onto the Angular side. So AngularJS have some features called data binding, hiding and showing the grids and all those things. We had some inbuilt features over there. The same thing. But it was not much, you can say, the user-friendly to the developer. User has to write a lot of codes over here. So what we have here, AngularJS follows the MVC architecture, model view, and the controller. Model is nothing but where you can write your business logics, where you can define your variables and the properties. But when we talk about view, view is nothing but your user interface. It's nothing but a designing of your application. When we talk about the controller, controller is a heart of your application in any technology, whether you talk about Java, whether you talk about MVC, whether you talk about web API or any place. So what happened? So as I told you, the controller is the heart of your application. It means whenever the client sends a request, the request will go to the controller. Then it will communicate to the respective model. Then it will return the data to the view again. This is called a MVC, model, view, and the controller. This was the approach was used in the AngularJS. But we had an issue, just like I'll tell you the example. I created a dropdown and I have used in the 5 different places, or you can say in the page, I have 5 tabs. And the same dropdown, I'm going to use it. And every dropdown is having the different data. So what was happening in the AngularJS, whenever I'm selecting something from the one dropdown, it was changing, it was reflecting the same index from first tab to till last tab. Means I have a 5 tabs and 5 tabs having the same component, same dropdown, but which will have a different data. But whenever I am selecting something from the first tab, automatically it is changing the index for the other tabs. So this is the biggest problem in the AngularJS. So to overcome this particular issue, we have some features in the AngularJS we called as a watch, apply. What is the benefit for that in the AngularJS? I can check that thing in the AngularJS, okay. What was the last index of this particular dropdown? Can I reset the value? What was the previous one? Because you have 5 tabs. In the first tab, you got selected in index 3. Then second tab, automatically it replaced with third index, the value got changed. So if we apply the watch method of the AngularJS, it will gives us the facility to track it. What was the previous value? What was the new value which I can use it to reset the drop-down values for the other tabs? So it was a very complicated things which we had it in the Angular. And there was some data bindings problems was also there in Angular 1.0. Now, after overcome these types of issues, we have the Angular 2 came into the picture, which have drastically the entire framework is being changed. Whatever you were doing in Angular 1, it is not in Angular 2. Concept will be same, but way of writing, the methods, the designing the architecture is completely different. as compared to the angular 1.0. So in angular 2, what we have it, we have some data binding features as we discussed on the last sessions. Okay. So I'm directly jumping into the main part of the Angular. I'll give you the backup class of the previous session again, so that you can understand in a very different way, and you can understand in very easiest way to understand like how it works and what was the other features, what Angular 2 Plus provides you. We are going to start from Angular 1, Angular 2 till 8. So Angular 8, I'm going to start from Angular 8 itself. It's nothing but your CLI command base. Because earlier you were writing a lot of codes to create Angular 2 project. When you try to create a project, you have to do right click, new folder, new file. These were the things which we were doing in Angular 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. But in Angular 8, we got a CLI command. CLI nothing but a command line interface, which will help you to create your CSS, create your projects, adding your routings and other stuff. This is the flexibility we got in Angular 8. So we'll start all those things in the Angular 8 application, but we'll be covering all those features which was in Angular 2 till current version. This is what we are going to do that. So let's start. What you need to do it in the first step. These are the things which we already discussed last time in the last session. What are those things? So I'm just recalling what is the Angular we discussed, why Angular came into the picture. We know HTML, we know DOM, document object model, we know the CSS for styling your page. JavaScript we know. TypeScript is nothing but a superset of your JavaScript. So in the JavaScript, you were writing a lot of codes, but in Angular, in the TypeScript, you don't be bother about it. You can utilize your OOPS concept, inheritance, all those things in the TypeScript itself. We'll study on the TypeScript also apart from the Angular. It also requires the basic concepts of OOPS. If you do not know the OOPS concept, we'll discuss these things also. Angular 1, it doesn't have any comparison with Angular 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. It's totally different. What we have in the Angular and what we are going to mainly focusing in the Angular application, Angular 2 Plus, modules, components, templates, metadata, data binding, directives, services, and dependency injections. We already discussed these things, but I'll repeat once again. When we talk about the modules, it's nothing but you can say, let's take an example. In the company, there are a number of departments. So one department we called as an HR department, one department we called as an admin department, something like that. So consider not going into the Angular part, just think about in a different way, like we are talking about in the real-time scenarios or real-time things. Module is nothing but you can consider as a department. If I'm developing an Angular admin application, just consider this is the module, which will have some components and all those things. Think in that way. Do not go into the Angular right now. Components is nothing but if I wanted to create a particular block of code, which can be reusable for the different places, we call it as a component. Templates is nothing but when we talk about defining the templates where you can put your logic, put your conditions, apply your other logics, we can use a template. Metadata, in simple words, we can say information about the classes, but in Angular, it is totally different. We'll talk about it, metadata. Data binding, whenever we talk about binding your data from one service to the components, service to the particular UI, in simple terms. The directives, it's nothing but a block of code, or we can have some different ways, structural directives, behavioral directives, we have it. We'll look into that one. Services, nothing but a making a call to the APIs. Or you can create your own service. Dependency injection means I'm going to inject something onto the particular function or onto the constructor. So that particular constructor will behave accordingly. If, for example, I wanted to log the information in the AWS or I wanted to log the information into the SQL database. So do I need to create two separate methods for that? No. I'll create a generic method. If I'm passing an object for the log information in SQL Server, my method will work accordingly. If I'm passing an object for the AWS, my function will work accordingly. This concept we called as dependency injections. Basic architecture we already discussed last time. The same thing we are having here. Module, just like I told you, it's nothing but a, you can say module admin department, HR department, and every module will have some components or related functionalities in simple terms. The templates where you can specify your bindings. There are a lot of bindings are available. Property binding, event binding, means whenever the user clicking on some action or performing an action on the particular control, it will raise or it will create one action event for you. It will generate an event. It will perform any action over there. Directives and the metadata is nothing but where we can specify our block of codes and some logics, because we have different ways of modifying the DOM element. So these features are available in our directives. So as I told you, modules is nothing but a block of code. Okay. Now, in the module, or you can say a module is a part of the department, something like that. So Angular module is a class which is decorated with the ng module. Okay, we'll talk about these things later. Let's go with the few basic things first, so that you can start directly doing the practical from the day one. Okay, you should not be wait for anything. So for developing any application, you should have do installation for either you can go with the Notepad++ or you can go with the Visual Studio Code. These are the open source technologies. You can install it, these softwares. We have WebStorm to developing your web Angular application. There are a lot of IDs are available in the market. You can download anyone. It's all more completely free of cost. Okay. If you do not have, I'll share you the PDF where you can download and do the setup and the installation. So let me show you how you can do. I'll sharing these PDFs by today itself after the session. Let's take Angular 2. So this PDF does have everything what we need to do it. Environment setup, what you need it, ID. We need a Node.js to making a call to the services. We have a NPM, NuGet Package Manager, Angular CI. These are the required things for developing an Angular 8 application. These are the steps, okay? Everything is there. From where you can download the Node.js, from where you can download the CLI command and all those things. I'm not going to discuss these things. This is the basic examples I have created for you. You can just have a look. Then we'll discuss in the detail. Do the installation by following these steps. I'm also going to do it right now so that you can understand it. Okay. But you can also have a look these things. Let's see. I'm going to create a fresh project in Angular. New window. What you need to do? First, I open the VS Code, go to the file, click on open folder. I do not have any folder right now. I'm going to create a folder for me. I'll be going to G Drive. I'm going to create one folder here, new. Folder demo session something. I given a name. Select a folder. It will give you the empty location. It doesn't have any things. Now Let's talk about one thing here, the most important part. If I want, first we have to install our NPM, NuGet Package Manager. How we can do it? You will have an option called terminal. Click on new terminal. First, I need to set up my environment where I can build my Angular application. First, I have to do npm install. This is the CLI command for doing the installation, developing an Angular application. Everything was written in my PDF. You can follow the steps wherever you stuck. Let me know. Call me anytime. We'll sit together and we'll have a session again. One-to-one if you want, or otherwise we can go this way also. So what we have to do it here. So we have to write npm install hyphen g is nothing but a global. If you wanted to install the npm throughout your system, you can use a hyphen g. If I'm not going to use a hyphen g, it will download, it will install the Angular or NPM things in my local folder. So I'm going to use it for the NPM install hyphen G for the entire machine. You have to use a @ symbol, Angular / CLI. This is a command for installing your NPM along Angular CLI framework to you. Press enter key. It will take little time for you to download each and everything here. So I started it. Just give me a second. It will be downloaded in shortly. Now see, it is downloading the files for me. Now everything got installed in my machine. The next step, what we have to do, we have to create a project. So I'm going to create a project. How we can create a project in Angular? We have to use ng. New. Ng stands for Angular. New. Give a project name. I'm going to give a project name means my project. Or I can give a name as session one. Press enter key. Once you run this command, see what it is asking me. It is asking me, would you like to add Angular routing? Routing means, we'll discuss later on, but for now, just understand routing means if you wanted to navigate something from here to there, just like in the HTML, we were using hyperlink, anchor tag. But in Angular, we have a concept called routing. It is the same concept available in MVC. So I'm going to click on yes or no. It's up to you for now. I'm clicking yes. Press enter key. Now it will ask me which type of style sheet you wanted to include it into your Angular application. Style sheet is nothing but an inbuilt CSS classes. It will add it to your project. So anything you can choose, either you can choose, there is an arrow key, up and down arrow key. See, I'm doing it. Anything you can choose it for now. So I'm selecting CSS. Press enter key. Now it is creating lot of CSS in my application. Once it will create it, I'm going to the other application where I already did this part. Everything, because it is downloading more than 10,000 files in your project. So I'm directly jumping to the other project which I already created for you. This is the things which you got it, which you will get it here after doing, after running this command. This will take time. So I already created it till this step. Now this is the most important part. If you understood the first session, which I'm going to tell you, at least you will understand the entire life cycle of the Angular. There are webhooks and all those things are available, but just ignore it for now. Now see, just understand these things. What is E2E? E2E stands for end-to-end testing. If you wanted to write your unit test cases, we have to write it here E to E. Where I can find a folder called SRC. There are two files. If you see, this is the TypeScript files. TypeScript files, nothing but you can say spec file. Specifications, we have it. Means how to do that, what are the configuration needed, those things we can configure it here for that testing. TSConfig will discuss later this part. The most important second part is node modules. When you run the command for creating an object or npm install, this folder is getting created here. Node underscore modules. It has more than 10,000 files for you in the Angular. Just like a libraries, you have it in your PHP or in Java or in the .NET technology. The next step is SRC. SRC folder is the main folder for us for developing Angular application. Whatever you are going to create it, you have to create it in SRC folder. So let's see whether it was created here. Still going on. Okay, leave it. SRC. Now expanding the SRC, these are the main things where you are going to work on it. This is the main default folder was created, app. App folder will have some default files. First, we'll be going to the appmodule.ts file. What it has. Appmodule.ts file where you can specify your business logics. It's nothing but your module. There is an app component.ts file. The component which you are going to create it and their business logics, you can put it here. Spec file, just leave it. Component.html where you can write your HTML code for designing the things, creating the HTML part. CSS for the styling it. And routing module.ts, it's nothing but for the routing part. For the navigation, just leave it for now. Asset folder is the main folder where you can specify your images, your CSS paths, your physical files. You have to store it into the assets folder. Another folder is the environment. If you see, we are having two files here, production and the normal QA, dev environment file. So whenever the code is going to be deployed onto the production environment, this file is going to be used. Otherwise, this file. Favicon icon is nothing but this icon we are talking about. Index.html file. Index.html file is the file whenever you are running an application, the first request always comes to the index.html page. I'll explain you a few things here. Main.ts file is the main file. When you launch your application, every application, every program required the entry point of your application. So main.ts file gives you the entry point for your application. Polyfill files, polyfills.ts file. It is for supporting the Angular application with the older versions of your browsers. For example, my application is not supporting an Internet Explorer browser. What I have to do? I have to include the polyfills.ts file. Then my application will work with IE. If my application is not working with the Opera browser, I have to write some code here so that it will work for Opera browser. That we called as a polyfills. Style.cs. CSS files. Yeah. Edit code. Dot editor config. There are few things, standards which you can define it here. Means how the IntelliSense will work on the CLI. And what will be the, when you press the space bar, what will be the space between the default this a default space between two words. These things we can specify here. The git ignore means if you're working with the GitHub, if you're working with the TFS, SVN, VSS, there would be some files which you don't need to commit it or checked in. Those things we can specify here. AngularJS, if you see this file, whatever, when I have run that command, npm install, everything is getting referenced here.